So the topic for today is called Remake, Remodel. And the idea for today is to show you the rich and complex worlds of imitative works in the history of art. So there are a lot of names used for when we recognize a borrowing or a quotation in works of art. So on my list here, I have appropriation, imitation, emulation, quotation, copy, forgery, or repurposing. There are many ways and modes of being in which to characterize how artists use past models and archival materials. It's a really interesting impulse to chart and think through in the history of art. So I will broadly refer to this suite of borrowings as a suite of relationships as borrowings. And they are of interest because they can and do result in something new and ignite the past in exciting ways and propel an artist's practice forward in many instances. So in this session, we're contemplating that kind of active mode of engagement and, you know, motivations for why artists remake and remodel and explore art that makes its relationship to the past very palpable. So also related to this, and the theme for sort of more towards the end of the lecture, is what art historians and critics are now referring to as an archival aesthetic. So the idea of using past sources very prominently within works of art. And in Australia in particular, what we see happening is a lot of artists engaging with colonial materials, often to the end of subversion or critique. And this results in some of those compelling pieces I can think of being created today. So to me, the archival aesthetic is in a way linked up to the subject of the first half of the lecture, this mode of appropriation or reuse or borrowing. I think what I'd like to have happen today is you leave here taking those words on board and sort of thinking that through next time you're in an art gallery and you see a sort of quotation or an element from previous work of art, you recognize it. It turns us, I think I used the word true detective. There's an appropriation right there. It's the name of a TV show, but true detective, you know, when we're really engaged with history of art, you end up with this kind of inventory of images and you can sort of often make these links that are really fascinating to think through. So that's the idea for today. So I'm less interested in forgery today, although forgery has a very interesting history in and of itself. That is a topic for another time. This is more about active reuse of materials and knowing that the audience will recognize it as, you know, it's not a forgery, basically. So that's, you know, the topic of art crime, which we can delve into at another point. I think one of the most noteworthy aspects of images, and, you know, I've found this fascinating ever since I started studying art history, is their potential to retain meaning long after creation and in diverse locations. You know, while other images, of course, stay obscure. So certain images just have this resonance that continues on well beyond the inception of the image. And I think typically it's stated, you know, images have an afterlife. That is a word that we use a lot in art history. I think a more appropriate claim is that images have lives, multiple lives. There's an art historian, James Elkins, he puts it this way. This is a quote, "Art historical images change meaning continuously in accordance with shifting contingencies of critical reception and historical circumstance." So that is sort of a thematic that courses through today. Which images endure? Why? Who preserves them? Who makes use of them? What contexts, you know, do we find these images in later? These are really important questions to be asked of works of art. So basically, thinking through and prioritizing reception, later reception, over the initial impetus to create the work of art. So we already got an insight into this with Natalia last week, so if you'll remember. She was talking about her engagement with, and even her initial disgust with, the art of the well-known modernist painter Willem de Koning. So let's recall, so de Koning, the image there on the far left, as a kind of model that she's using to different kind of end. And you'll recall de Koning was famous for his series of women paintings from the late 1940s and early 1950s. When you study art history and you think through modernism, what you learn is that de Koning, when he began to paint his women, he did so at a moment when pure abstraction was very dominant in American art, and the human figure was actually seen as a rather obsolete subject, but he takes it on anyway. And his famous quote, and I mentioned this last week as well, was flesh. He says, flesh is the reason oil painting was invented. He wanted to explore the human form, and in particular, women's. And I think you can see for yourselves how this painting is distinguished by these vigorous and gestural and very powerful brush strokes. This is about painting and about the mark of the artist. And one way of thinking about it is that the image kind of gets assembled before us. We can imagine it being constructed there. I thought it was very interesting last week when Natalia said, you know, she tried to replicate it, and technically speaking, it's a very challenging approach to painting, and I do think that's very true. So the idea of a kind of palpable testimony there to the process of its creation, and there's obviously a rejection of the idea of a finished painting, which had dominated art history for a long time. Every stroke is palpable, and there's a kind of speed and energy and agitation about de Koning's approach. And in light of our conversation last week, I sort of unearthed this quote from de Koning. He said, beauty becomes petulant to me. I like the grotesque. We spent a lot of time with the grotesque last week, you'll remember. It's more joyous, he says. And I think, you know, his work is often noted for having a kind of gaudy and exaggerated element, and that works in with what we were thinking through with the grotesque, indeed. The figure is kind of merging with its indeterminate space. Now, the painting, of course, and Natalia mentioned this, was opened up, his series was opened up to sort of accusations of misogyny. You know, the series is titled Woman 1, Woman 2, Woman 3, you know, very non-specific, sort of robbing the women of their identity, if you will. Often also critiqued for being objectifying women and a fairly violent approach to depicting women. So our artist, Natalia, picks up on this, right? She made it her project to critique what is happening in de Koning, right? And the way she does it, this is sort of our entry into the whole world of appropriation and borrowings and how it can be really compelling and interesting. What does Natalia do? Well, she takes de Koning's model and renders the flesh with a precision and meticulous patterns. She, in a way, orders the chaos and brings a decorative element into it. She was annoyed by how de Koning titled his works, right? Woman 1, Woman 2. She wanted to bring a greater sense of identity, I suppose, to the models. Think through the models themselves. We recognize the de Koning painting as a source, and at the same time, we recognize Natalia's subversion of many of the elements in it. And of course, her own multidisciplinary practice is concerned with the decorative and ornamental traditions and their association with the feminine, the body, and excess. And so here, she engages in a kind of critique and indeed even subversion of a modernist artist like de Koning. I have a quote here from Natalia, which I'd like to read out to you. She says, I was never enthralled by that thick expressionist painting style in the same way that other people seem to be. I've always been a very flat, neat painter. I was drawn to de Koning, not because he has a decorative aesthetic, but because I wondered what would happen if I brought that aesthetic to his work. This artist would have loathed me to do that, I'm sure. So, right, so it doesn't matter what de Koning thinks in a way, right? But I find this is an absolutely compelling example of the kind of relationship I want to chart. Going back to the Renaissance and just thinking it through in terms of earlier examples of how artists have made use of earlier models, often sometimes with homage in mind, so a kind of nod to the brilliance of a past master and wanting to learn from them, and we'll look at some examples of that, but then also subversion. And that idea is, I think, very interesting, and especially when we get to the later examples that we'll look at in terms of Australian artists taking on the kind of European tradition and also colonial instances that are sort of, in a way, subverted through their art practice. So making borrowings, showing you how active they are, rather than just lumping everything together in the idea of copying, if you will. There's a very active element to this. Okay. So one other quote I have here is from the art historian Abby Varburg, and this is a quote I often use to think through what I'm about to explore today. He says, "We are witnesses of the migration of images." I love this quote because it helps us consider, as I said, you know, earlier, the lives of images, what happens when they're transported to a new place. And I mean, we are in a gallery that collects, has a broad collecting mandate. So, and as I mentioned to you last week, I've looked through a lot of our permanent collection, all 11,000 photographed images, but and thinking through the journeys those works of art have been on, how they've come to be where they are, is a whole strand of art historical scholarship that's quite fascinating. So, but also, the idea of pictures undergoing histories of reception, okay? So, and this is something I have written about quite a bit in terms of the reception of an artist. I'm especially interested in Albrecht Dürer, so how his work was picked up upon in the late after his death. So my book about Dürer starts with his death, basically, so 1528 to 1700, and thinking through how the images take up new lives beyond the initial creation by their creator. Okay, so that's where I'm coming from with all of this. I think it's important to note, though, that for the early modern period especially, this impacted not just art, but also music and poetry. Imitation, modes of imitation, this was one of the most widespread practices in all branches of artistic endeavor. So composers, as well as poets and painters, learned their craft by imitating older masters. And I can cite for you a lot of different classical treatises on this, treatises that urge imitation as initially a pedagogical exercise necessary in the journey towards creating something new. So you'll find in the 15th and 16th and certainly 17th century, the issue is not should we imitate, but rather who do we imitate? Who are our best models? It's sort of a given that imitation is a mode of engagement. And a kind of, yes, there's a lot of interesting written debates around all of this. I see it as my job to sort of chart through the, as I said, artistic reception and active engagement. And, you know, I'm going to say even further, I mean, in terms of academic training for artists, that propels right through into the 19th century. Just to give you maybe two examples, I mean, an analogy that often gets used in these treatises is the idea of bees collecting nectar, then that then gets transformed into honey. So you see all kinds of classical treatises where the argument is, so a poet gathers together the goes from flower to flower collecting, and then there's the transformative element that happens in the hive when the nectar gets transformed into honey. And that gets compared to the process of a poet, the process of a musician. So you need to gather together, you need to study, you need to think through all these previous examples, have that on board, and then transform into something new. This model is in place for a really long time in the European tradition. I'll just read you a quote from Erasmus very quickly, important German humanist, and he states, "If we wish to imitate Cicero successfully, we must above all disguise our imitation of Cicero." So basically learn from antiquity, but then have that transformative element enter the picture. One writer who I found especially useful for this is a guy called Bartolomeo Ricci, and he's writes a text that is specifically about modes of imitation. Okay, and he identifies, this is published around in the mid-16th century in Venice, and Ricci gives a really explicit discussion of divergent forms of imitation. He's talking about Virgil, and what he says is this, though following imitation and emulation are three entirely different species, they are similar and do belong to one class. And then he goes on to contrast these three modes. The first division he calls following, okay? And he says this is the gathering or borrowing of phrases, sentences, and passages, which is in a way a kind of transcription of the models found in a text. And then the second division he calls imitation. And he says this involves a situation in which the differences between text and model are at least as pronounced as the resemblances. And imitation there is intended as a kind of homage. There are clear references to past models, and borrowed materials are, you know, highlighted prominently. So there's a respect and acknowledgement of a past source. And then finally, and this is where it gets super interesting, the third category, emulation, which involves a more critical reflection on or even correction of a past model. There's an awareness of the historical distance between present and past, and in emulation, kind of uses of that past model are seen as great evidence of skill. So emulation goes beyond imitation, implies a kind of challenge to that past model. So again, a very active engagement with the past, remembering this is the 16th century. And in other words, there are receptive and productive aspects to how emulation works. And he again uses that analogy of the bees that I just mentioned, which is in Seneca, all kinds of antique authors. So with all of that as background, what I want to really get into today are some works that I found in our permanent collection. And be mindful that, you know, my brief around this art course was to explore the international permanent collection. But I have branched off. There are plenty of Australian artists more coming up about at the halfway point. But I did want to show you works that I found especially noteworthy in terms of this thematic, okay? Because we do have quite a few. So this, obviously the work on the right is not in our collection. If you've been to Rome, you'll recognize the Laocoon from the Vatican. But on the left is a drawing that is in our collection. I was really interested to find this. And William Eddy is not an artist I know a great deal about. He was one of the last English academic history painters, so an academic artist who was very savvy with copying works for pedagogical purposes. And in 19th century England, when he would have been active, you know, there was no higher honor than to be admitted to the Royal Academy. So he had a long, esteemed career at the Royal Academy, was admitted in 1807, worked with artists like John Constable, who's probably a name that's familiar to you. And to enter the Academy, you had to pass tests. Artists had to pass tests. All successful applicants were expected to produce very high-quality drawings of sculptures. And the most prestigious form of painting was still history painting. So history painting accommodating mythology and religion, basically, as your most important subjects. This was a way to show themselves as equal to or even superior to old masters. You're entered into that competition with the past, if you will. So, and Eddy, you know, as I dug a bit further, I mean, there's one other drawing by him in the collection, and it's a nude figure, and there's all kinds of interesting sources swirling around Eddy and a kind of He seemed to have had a rather negative relationship with John Constable, actually, who I mentioned as a fellow academic artist. And Eddie, you know, really liked doing nude drawings. And there was some criticism around that, saying he likes to do an awful lot of, you know, but he used the pretext of mythology. And if you did the Met course last time, you'll remember I talked about that, how mythology is a kind of genre that allows artists to depict nudes. But he did a lot of live models as well. So here he's created a drawing of a really well-known work of art, probably the most copied and imitated sculpture of all time. Of course, the famous Leo Kuan, which up until, say, the 19th century, anyone interested in art would know that sculpture, would care about it, would probably have created a drawing after it. It's sort of an infamous work. There are copies and models of it in heaps of other collections. You know, if for an artist in training to copy the Leo Kuan was in a really important mode of engagement. So I don't want to assume everyone knows this work. So I want to say a little bit about it because it absolutely opens up us up into this world of copying and imitation and how it works. So the sculpture from antiquity was rediscovered in Rome in 1506, and the impact was electric. The subject there is the Trojan priest Laocoon and his sons, and you can see there they're basically being devoured by or encircled by these sea serpents. Okay, so what's happening? As with a lot of classical stories, there are multiple sources for this one. So he's a priest of the god Apollo in Troy. What has he done to deserve this punishment? Well, one version has Laocoon offending the gods by breaking his oath of celibacy and having sex with his wife in Apollo's sanctuary, which is a no-no. Another version from Virgil's epic poem Aeneid from the first century stems more directly from the Trojan War. And Laocoon warns his fellow citizens against accepting the Trojan horse, we know this story, left by the Greeks. And Laocoon hurled his spear against the horse to prove it was hollow, and thus incurred the wrath of the gods. He had desecrated an object that was dedicated to the goddess Athena. You don't do that either. You don't offend Apollo, you don't offend Athena. They're very high up in the hierarchy of gods and goddesses. For both of these stories, we have this result. So the sea god Poseidon sends two giant sea serpents, and they're even named in the poem. You know, serpents have names, to crush Laocoon and his twin sons, to kill them, basically. And I think you'll agree the sculpture is very dramatic. The way it was discovered was also dramatic. So I mentioned 1506, this sculpture gets unearthed in Rome. Last week we talked about the grotesque and how that was found in subterranean caves. Similar here, the Laocoon sort of unearthed, remarkably intact. I mean, basically you can see there's a couple of limbs missing, but in remarkably good shape. And, you know, absolutely the effect of this is electrifying in terms of anatomy, in terms of the graphic depiction of the story. But particularly how the human form is depicted there. This just resonated. Artists in the Renaissance are sort of thinking through anatomy in all kinds of interesting ways, and finding Rome antiquities like this that showed that the human figure had been depicted this way before was electrifying for them. One artist who it had a huge effect on, and you'll know this if you've already looked at your sheet, who I'm about to talk about now, is Michelangelo. When the Laocoon was discovered, it was reported to the Pope at the time, Pope Julius II, who sends Michelangelo in to investigate. And actually there's a whole strand of art historical research that suggests that Michelangelo perhaps forged the sculpture. It's sort of, talk about true detective and art crime. I mean, it was thought it's too good. You know, it's just too intact. Did Michelangelo actually create this? Is it a forgery? a topic for another time. What I want to say today is that the effect of seeing the Laocoon on Michelangelo's own art was enormous. He starts depicting the human figure in extraordinary and extreme ways. This idea of contrapposto, so contrapposto is a term we use a lot in art history, the idea of counterpose, so a body that's twisting and contorting and experiencing the throes of violence like that, makes its way into his work in sculpture and in paint. So it's a really concrete and direct example of how work from the past can have a massive impact on an artist in their present and what they do and how they present things. And quotations of the Laocoon, in fact, can be found in all kinds of Renaissance works of art. Direct quotations of the chest of the main figure, of the limbs of the main figure. And in this instance, what I'm showing you are these two so-called slaves that Michelangelo created for the tomb of Pope Julius II. So this was one of these enormous projects that was started and never quite got finished. A commission for a tomb of the Pope, so it's 1505, Pope Julius says, okay, Michelangelo, I want the best and biggest tomb you can possibly imagine. It's going to be, you know, 10 meters high. There's going to be 40 figures on the front of it. It's going to have prophets from the Old Testament, is going to have New Testament figures. It's going to have slaves who represent all the colonies that I've got. You know, I've conquered all these lands, etc. So it's this massive, massive project. And Michelangelo is okay, starts doing it. Pope Julius dies. He's finished three of the sculptures. It was a project that kept getting delayed and delayed. You know, little things came up like, go paint the Sistine ceiling, please, and you know, things like that. So it's a really interesting unfinished project, in fact. And so the two slaves are two of the works Michelangelo actually did complete here. So about 15, 13, 15, 16, and that pair of sculptures are in the Louvre. We see here another word that's often used with Michelangelo is in the Italian, terribilità. So this is a word that he uses, that people who are talking about Michelangelo use, and basically it's indicative of this emotional intensity that's present in, like, emotion as manifest in the body. So the twisting muscular bodies of the subject are part of a very endemic to Michelangelo's oeuvre and how he's presenting, using contortion to, in fact, express something around sin. And with these two, the way the slaves are sort of bound up in those cloths is reminiscent and a kind of quotation or, in fact, emulation of the same thing happening to Laocoon and his sons. So a kind of direct line can be traced here that I think is really, really fascinating. So we can see this elsewhere, as I mentioned. A great number of paintings by Michelangelo. Oh, one thing I have here in my notes to mention to you is a quotation from Michelangelo where he says, you know, he's hit the end of, it's 1542, he still hasn't finished all of the works for the tomb of Julius II, and even though he wants to, even though the Pope has passed on years before, and his quote is, "And so I find I've lost all my youth tied to this tomb." You know, he's spent all this time, you know, never gets it done. So I really find that quite interesting. And here, so in another engagement, direct engagement with emulation of the Laocoon, we see Michelangelo in paint. And this is from in the Sistine Chapel on the back wall, there's the Last Judgment, which Michelangelo comes in to paint years after painting the ceiling. So he does the ceiling around 1508. He comes to do the whole back wall of the Sistine Chapel with the Last Judgment in 1536. The Counter-Reformation is raging. Michelangelo, famously a tortured artist who is thinking about sin a lot and possibilities for redemption towards the end of his life. I mean, again, the idea of the saved and the damned, very important to him. And here, this is just a little snippet of the bottom part of the Last Judgment where it shows hell and what happens to the damned who head down there. And in Greek mythology, He's shown us here Minos, the king of Crete, who is the son of Zeus and Europa, and one of the three judges of the underworld after his own death. And Michelangelo's depicted Minos with donkey ears and wrapped in these serpent coils. Again, you know, a nod to the sculpture that was so important to his oeuvre. Now, this is also an act of subversion, and I'll tell you why. And I think when we think about these old masters like, you know, Rubens, Michelangelo, Raphael, etc., we do need to recall they were rebels in their own time as well. They're so recognized now as old masters and, you know, kind of the canon of art history. But in the moment, there are plenty of instances in which they acted in subversive ways. According to Vasari, who of course is a great historian of all of this, the facial features of Minos here, in the guise of the king of Crete, are of a particular cardinal. We even know his name, Baigio da Cesena, who was critical of Michelangelo's nudes on the ceiling. You know, had that been painted, generated? He's like, these nudes, no, they don't belong in a chapel. It's terrible. How dare you? This day, this is better for a bar, tavern, you know, whatever. That, how could Michelangelo sort of taint this holy place? So when Michelangelo comes back to the Sistine Chapel to create the Last Judgment, he's got this in mind, and he, in fact, it's thought, includes the facial, recognizable facial features of this particular cardinal in the guise of, you know, judge of the underworld. That is not flattering. You know, it's just really nasty, a very subversive thing to do. And apparently the cardinal complained. He was quite angry, complained directly to the Pope. And then this is not documented in Vasari, but it's sort of like an urban legend that the Pope then explained he had no jurisdiction over hell and the port would have to remain. You know, so basically he can't, hell's there, too bad, Cardinal. I cannot ask Michelangelo to change it. So, I mean, and this, you know, if any of you have been to the Sistine Chapel, and I hope many of you have or can go in the future, you know, this is a small figure, you know, this is what I mean about being a true detective, sort of finding these little corners of art history where there are these delightful, you know, and incredible, and in this case, subversive elements to seemingly like canonical works with great masterpieces, etc. But there's cheeky elements as well. And that does link back to last week where we were talking about humor, right? So my point is that the mythological Laocoon was a touchstone, and you know, here this involves an updated symbol for contemporary politics, a kind of embedded critique, which is really fascinating. Now, you know, I'm getting a lot of mileage out of the Eddie drawing you can see here, but again, just to say that, you know, there is a long, well-documented history of how much of an impact Laocoon had on artists. And one of my favorite appropriations of the sculpture is by El Greco. And he's, of course, he's a Greek artist who's active in Spain. His dates are 1541 to 1614. And he's really well known for a vivid, mystical approach to his faith. And what's interesting about this one is this is the only time, you know, I mentioned at the very beginning, history painting is still seen as the modus operandi for artists. You do mythology, you do religion. This is the only time he does a mythological story. So again, I think attesting to just how powerful the Laocoon model was for artists. And it's thought that El Greco possibly intended, he's shown the figures with a recognizable view of Toledo in his time, and is he trying to relate this mythical theme of conflict and divine retribution to the Inquisition, which was then raging? You know, there's no definitive answer to that, in fact, but we can see his engagement with the figures is really different from Michelangelo's. You know, again, we have Laocoon and his two sons, although here one of the sons is already dead. And the identity of the figures on the far right is debated. No one really knows. who they are supposed to represent. But these strange, like, elongated forms, he's playing with how to depict a body in a very different way from Michelangelo. And these sort of twisting acrobatic lines, very eerie atmosphere, writhing forms, you know, a kind of absence of color, like a pallor of death almost, I think, with those forms. They almost resemble statuary more than anything. And the space is kind of irrational, and there's a sort of surreal quality to this. And then, you know, El Greco is much loved by later artists who pick up on, you know, Picasso really liked him. There's a resonance that we can indicate going the other way as well. I think that is really compelling. So I just wanted to throw that in there. Now, we're even going to do poetry in this corner. I'm not going to read out this whole poem, but it's just there for you in your notes, because as a sort of aside here, when I think of the Laocoon and the power of that sculpture and the idea of a sculptural fragment as inspiration, I mean, there's a lot to be said in the history of art around that. And, you know, here you have another work that was unearthed during those massive excavations in Rome in the 16th century, the so-called Belvedere Torso. And like the Laocoon, there are countless engravings and woodcuts and drawings. Artists flocked to see it, sketched it, and then remodel going forward, using the form as a way, a kind of jumping platform for their own art. And that happens with poetry as well. So for me, Rainer Maria Rilke is just one of the most interesting poets that, you know, of all time. And this poem he wrote about the fragment, about the Belvedere Torso, I think is incredibly powerful and points to another mode of engagement, you know, ekphrasis. So the idea of putting into words something you see, which is a lot harder to do than, you know, it's a challenging task. And his poem really taps into, I think, the power of this fragment. Again, I won't, it's for you to have a look at maybe another time, but I mean, the idea of the god pulsating like a star, the torso even talks at the end, you must change your life, like, oh, you know, it's sort of a very intense way of engaging with a work that is incomplete, a fragment, you know, rediscovered. So just pointing again to that kind of inspiration that can occur when prominently thinking through past models like this. Okay, now on to work that is in our collection, the middle work. This here's a chain, a chain of influence, a chain of thinking, a chain of understanding. Again, this idea of how past models reoccur. I mentioned Rubens last week. I mean, he's another giant of the history of art, one of the biggest artists of the 17th century. And his career is very interesting in terms of how he takes on almost an encyclopedic approach to humanism. He sketches everything he sees. He travels around just sketching, developing a kind of compendium of not only things like the Laocoon, the Belvedere Torso, but also works of other artists. So he heads to Italy. He wants to sketch Veronese, Titian, Michelangelo. And there are just thousands of sheets of drawings by Rubens where he's looking to the past and trying to assimilate it in a way in order to develop towards a new mode of creating. So a very studied approach to art. And so the middle one is in our collection. I remember when I first moved to Brisbane, this was 12 years ago, and I went and I was like, I know that, I've seen that before. And it's indeed, our Rubens there is a copy of this work by Titian on the far left, okay? So the Titian is in Vienna in the Kunsthistorisches Museum, the Rubens here, and then on the far right, what has always been argued in Rubens scholarship as an emulation of the first work, the Titian on the left, Helena Fourmont, his wife in a fur robe. Basically, the argument here, the chain, is that he created the copy after the Titian, a very direct copy, and then takes that back with him to Antwerp, and then reworks and remodels and recreates in a kind of homage and nod to Titian, but at the same time, I'm better than Titian, this kind of thing. I'm going to take his model. And what's interesting there is he uses a full-length approach, full-length composition. Hardly anyone got a full-length treatment in those days. So he's, and this is his wife, it was a private picture, it wasn't intended for sale. He referred to it very affectionately in writings, his wife as well as the painting. And this is his borrowing from Titian and recreating, making something new out of it. So, and the thing to bear in mind is that in those days, they would have expected and wanted recognition of that borrowing. From the perspective of collectors, for example, so I mentioned earlier this idea of migration of works of art and where they are is an important part of their stories. you know, we know that, for example, all the Phillips in Spain, many of the collectors there, they really valued works that were sort of had a double-pronged approach in terms of who created them. So a work by Rubens after Titian was thought to have the talents of both artists in there. So it becomes, and there are instances of collectors paying more for these kinds of imitative works, of valuing them very highly indeed. In particular, Rubens, who this isn't the only time he does this kind of thing, Rubens, Velasquez, we can think of scores of works of theirs where there are intentional nods to the past. And, you know, I find this really interesting. And, you know, you look at the 17th century art theory, and as I quoted from the beginning, there are suggestions of imitation as a completely vital and important mode of working. You know, artists were thought to have the ability to single out and choose examples from the past for imitation, and that would allow for a new mode of painting to emerge. And so making a copy, as Rubens has done here with the Titian, was a highly instructive process. It was a way of adopting a past style, and almost as if that past master is guiding the pupil's hand. So solutions, you know, it was just a very studied approach. And you could solve pictorial composition by absorbing past accomplishments of previous artists. So in short, I mean, the impulses of copying, imitation, and emulation had really strong currency, as attested to by this sequence. And, you know, as I said, a significant point to be made is that many of those imitative works were not thought of as insignificant or lesser, but rather they were valued and, in fact, paid dearly. You know, artists, collectors would pay dearly for them. I mean, another example I can think of that I'm not going to show is how Bernini borrows from Michelangelo in this period. Quotations that are proudly acknowledged, and there are repeated comparisons between Bernini and Michelangelo in the art theory of the period as well. And, you know, patrons actually encouraging this to happen. And patrons had a lot of say in those days around what would be created. But in this instance, it wasn't a patron insisting upon this. It was Rubens himself who's entering into this mode. So with the Helena Fourmont painting, he's paying homage to Titian's Girl in Fur. This is not a copy, but rather a second presentation of the same theme. So borrowing from the past to emulate and create something new. Okay. Now, here's one of the most celebrated borrowings in the history of art. And if you do a course on modernism, you often start with Le Déjeuner sur l'Herbe. It's not in our collection, but this is the work on the left, the Marc-Antonio Raimondi print that was part of it used as a model for what Manet is doing. And Manet, of course, is often heralded as an artist who's right at the start of the birth of modernism, if not the main artist for the birth of modernism. And Manet, like William Etty, who we looked at earlier, understood copying as necessary to his training, but also understood, like probably Rubens, that this could lead to a new formulation. Where Etty was wedded to the Royal Academy in London, we have our Manet, who's in fact rejecting the traditional tastes at the Paris Académie des Beaux-Arts, the organization that's responsible for France's annual art salons. And if you know the history of Impressionism, you'll know how seminal this moment is and how Manet matters to this kind of rejection of history painting, mythology and religion as the main subjects for art. What I'd like to just sort of iterate in the context of this lecture is that this doesn't mean that borrowing from past simply goes away. And the idea of art created in a vacuum is a modernist myth, as Natalia and I were talking about last week. I think that if you think of the Déjeuner sur l'herbe and what's going on there, you know, you could sort of divide it up in terms of what makes it revolutionary. You can think through the subject, you can think through the scale, and you can think through the composition. So if we think of our subject here, I mean, it's fairly ordinary. It's two gentlemen, two women out for a picnic. You can see the picnic in the foreground there. The strange thing is, though, that one of the women is just naked, right? So it's a strange picnic. See, I feel like this is a painting everyone kind of knows. I don't want to kind of belabor it here, but it is a strange, you know, if you consider on the left our mythological scene, the Judgment of Paris, it's okay, everyone's naked, it makes sense. This is mythology, right? But you go to the right, we've got a picnic, we've got a nude figure. It's odd. Manet knew this, okay? This is, he knows what he's doing. I have a quote from him, he says, "So they'd prefer me to do nude, would they? Fine, I'll do them a nude. And then I suppose they'll really tear me to pieces. They'll tell me I'm just copying the Italians now rather than the Spanish." That is a really interesting statement around all the things we're talking about today. He's giving a new context to the nude here. He's showing a seemingly ordinary everyday scene and just kind of with a hint of irony, sort of challenging us a bit, like, what is weirder? Oh yeah, I can see. The scale of it, it's huge. It's, you know, 208 by 264 centimeters. I mean, until Manet, artists typically reserved canvases of this size for academic and history paintings, as I've mentioned, the big subjects, so allegory, history, mythology. An ordinary scene on a large scale, right? Your labels matter. So thinking through something, how big it is, how small it is, what are the dimensions, you know? It's a strange world here where I can sort of make the print as big as the painting, if you see what I'm saying. But just keeping that in mind, you know, this is a large-scale painting. And in terms of the composition, I mean, it's directly inspired by, you know, he knew people would recognize this. This is absolutely fine. One of the works I'm not showing you, which is a Titian painting called The Pastoral, which shows it's an allegory and it does have nude figures in there. Representing poetry and music, along with two clothed figures. So that's in the Louvre. Manet spent a lot of time in the Louvre copying things, training, etc. So we know that that is one of his models. And the other one, which you have here, this print by Marco Antonio Raimondi, if you look at the far right of the print, you've probably all seen and noticed already, the composition there is directly happening in the Manet scene. So those are sea gods gathered while Paris does his judgment of who's the most beautiful and starts the Trojan War, basically. And I mean, Marco Antonio Raimondi in and of himself opens up all kinds of issues around copying and borrowing and imitation. I mean, he does a lot of what we call reproductive engravings and, you know, so pulling back to him in the 16th century, I mean, he's going around creating engravings after all kinds of works of art because that's how the ideas get transmitted, by the distribution of prints. Works on paper can move around in that time in a way the actual paintings cannot. So he had a very close working relationship with Raphael and engaged in copying. And then, of course, he has a very cheeky relationship with Albrecht Dürer, who at one point accuses him of forging his prints Anyway, you see this world, like it just, like you start somewhere and then you kind of spiral and spiral and spiral and see all kinds of relationships and rapports and dialogues. That's how I like to think of it, kind of dialogues happening. So, as I mentioned, it was very, I was interested to find this particular Raimondi work in our collection and thinking, I think someone was thinking through, this is a very famous relationship to notice. I wasn't a detective with this one. It just, you know, is often noted. So again, that borrowing from that past model. Okay, now let's look at some Australian works and New Zealand works. I was gonna throw this out there. I think if any of my students are here, they'll know where we're going now. Does anyone know what model I might throw up here for this one? We've got four horses storming through. You know I'm crazy about Albrecht Dürer. Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, okay? So I love this dialogue here, this relationship. I think it's really interesting. We've got Albrecht Dürer's Four Horsemen and this wonderful artist from New Zealand, Kushana Bush, who I'm enjoying researching and thinking about and reading about. And Kushana Bush studied art in Otago. She lives in Dunedin. She was represented, I think, in APT 6 or I can't remember. But there's a really interesting historicism at work in her art that all of what I've just gathered together for you should present itself as kind of background for now this next suite of images that I think draw on past works of art in really interesting, compelling ways. Kushana Bush paints exclusively in gouache, which is a thick, opaque kind of watercolor, and you can't really fix mistakes with it, so it's a very meticulous process. She is very interested in depicting, you know, she makes a lot of allusions to Persian manuscripts, Japanese prints, medieval and Renaissance art history. One quotation I read around her work was pointing forwards to an afterwards, and Bush is deliberately elusive and eclectic, and myths are still happening in a timeless present, worldliness in the ordinary. So a lot of different, she's drawing a lot of different elements, images that are pulled on from all over the place, asking us, you know, and this is I think why I'm so interested in it, you know, where do they come from? What's the source here? What's the source there? Dürer is not the only source being pulled on here. And I think she's very interested in sort of the persistence of mythology to the present day. We tend to think of mythology as something relegated to the past. For her, it's still very alive. And she tends to draw these mythological elements together or these past models with everyday things. So I think you can see one of the horsemen has a sort of bucket on his head. There's this spoon race going on. There's thongs. There's, I say flip-flops because I'm from Canada, but there's these thongs there. So it's this marriage of the old with the new and kind of this, you know, you could spend a lot of time working through the different relationships that are apparent here. And, you know, of course, the Dürer image is iconic from the Apocalypse series. You know, these four horsemen stampeding through at the end of the world, an apocalyptic moment. These are the damned, you know, war, pestilence, plague, swarming through to take care of those who have not made it safely to heaven. You have Hades there on the far left, kind of sweeping up everything that the horsemen don't trample on. And that makes its way into Kushana's work here, which you can see sort of the horses. You can also see the scales that are carried by one of the riders in the Dürer directly over there. So a lot to work through. And I'll just read you one quote from her that I thought was really interesting. She loves Giotto. She says, "When I look at a lovely Giotto, I don't have a true understanding of the biblical stories he was depicting. I end up sort of cobbling together some interpretation. In this sense, most modern audiences are visually illiterate when looking at art of other times and places. In saying that, they still find them mysteriously powerful and moving. And Giotto's adoration of the Magi, for instance, I don't really know why that story is important in the Bible, but I can relate to it on the basic level that babies are miraculous and that this is something in life to celebrate. I'm very attracted to that cycle of collapsing interpretations. It keeps you yearning." Very interesting. She also talks about the collision between cultures. That's manifest in a lot of her work as well. And she says, these works are informed by European books of ours as they, sorry, these books are as informed by European books of ours as they are by Persian miniatures. Both East and West employed a miniature format with finely applied gouache and gold leaf and bound in a book as a visual aid to assist in a relationship with God. The divide between East and West is not so big. We've been singing from a similar hymn book for centuries. So I find that really compelling, and to me, the style of her work is really appealing. It's yes. So I've been sort of thinking through when I encountered her work in the collection. I knew that I wanted to bring that into discussion in terms of those many borrowings. And there's a few other artists who I want to share with you as not necessarily artists I know tons and tons about, but artists that I think are interesting from the perspective of these thematics and who point to a continued dialogue with the a continued appreciation of imitation as a mode of working in art today. Now this one, you know, you could argue with me if you wanted. That would be great, actually, because this is me sort of pushing this thesis a little further, because this isn't quite a, you know, direct borrowing from Schongauer. But I don't know, I think I love finding reasons to talk about this Schongauer print because it's so fantastic. So we have, you know, on the left, St. Anthony, who is being tormented by demons, and he's very stoic there, isn't he? I mean, he's being pushed and pulled and beaten with sticks, and it's supposed to show, of course, the Christian kind of stoicism in the face of calamity and, you know, his elevated status as an important saint in the Christian church. And, you know, a lot of our historians have spent time trying to think of which source this was drawn from, etc. But I think we can safely say it's a fairly stunning image that really captures a kind of, yeah, a saint tormented. I mean, this, and a kind of dreamlike quality about it. Now, when I hit Sayra Wasim's work in the collection, and this was an artist who I'd never heard of before, and I did a little research, and she's active in the U.S., and she's originally from Pakistan, and she also has this interest in sort of Persian miniatures and collision of cultures and drawing on elements from what she says East and West and putting them into synthesis. And to me, this work kind of has that, you know, this is an art historian talking about sort of form and composition. And to me, it's like sort of an antithesis of the Schongauer. And this is what I mean by art history being a sort of creative enterprise, because I could absolutely craft an essay that is about these two works in conjunction, even though they're separated by all this time, even though I have no documentation, unlike with Kushana. Kushana says directly, I borrowed from the Durer. The Durer work matters. Here, it's not even essential, I don't think. It's something I'm noticing. It's something I'm thinking through. There's a creative element going on in terms of thinking of this as a possible answer to what Schongauer is pointing at. I find there's a queasy sense in Cesaria Wasim's depiction here. Are those creatures asleep? Is this the pallor of death? Such a jumble could never fully exist, these human figures, you know, together with all the different animals, yet we're all part of an ecosystem where events have ramifications for all. I mean, there's a long way that you could spin this out. Is it better to be alive and tormented instead of what's happening there? So this is imaginative leaps, but that's part of what we do. you know, my students hate slide tests, and I've always been told I should stop doing them. But this is another borrowing here, and I don't expect recognition of it, but our artist, Lindy Lee, so I'll just go straight through to what it's borrowed from. And Lindy Lee is absolutely, you know, a wonderfully compelling artist. I remember there was a big exhibition of her works at the UQ Art Museum. I work at UQ, and I remember distinctly how marvelous it was to walk through and see all of her works together in that solo show. And she's, you know, an Australian, Brisbane-born artist, and her practice explores her Chinese ancestry through her Buddhist practice. And she has a lot of, you know, I won't list her resume. I mean, there's a very interesting resource through the QAGOMA site where you can read a lot more about Lindy Lee's work. What I want to point out today is that her early practice really often referenced the European canon and questioned the notion of authenticity in artistic practice. So there are quotations from Jan van Eyck, Titian, El Greco, Rembrandt, and early on she did a number of photocopy works. I think especially when she was a graduate student at Sydney College of Arts, and she would choose all these different images from Western art history and photocopy them over and over, allowing them to fade and, you know, kind of get tattered and disintegrate a little bit. And I think her practice is firmly about this idea of questioning ideas around originality, reproduction. She's thinking through the weight of Western art history. And, you know, then she ends up reaching very deep into her ancestral roots and notions of belonging. And she's a first generation Chinese Australian artist working in the present. But I just find this engagement with the past really interesting. And, you know, looking at Lindy Lee's work and just, again, trying to think through that, what's being borrowed, what's at work here. Alongside those photocopy works I mentioned, she did all these encaustic works, so like hot wax paintings. Edward Collis described her process in an interview in 1994. So how over an underlying color, Lee would apply thick monochrome layers of oil and wax, and then she would cut into and scrape back through these layers to find different tones of color, modeling her figures in an ultra shallow space and a kind of arduous and physical process like etching or erosion. And pointing to a kind of archaeology around her work, an archaeological impetus. Now, so when I was going through all the works in the collection and I hit this, I was like, I've seen this somewhere before, I know. And then I just kept thinking it's this figure reaching. And she's chosen sort of one of the most, maybe I'll circle it here on the, you can see here, this figure here. So of course, this really well-known work of art, The Raft of Medusa by Theodore Jericho, which of course depicts this moment when, so a ship from France has gone aground near, been basically capsized near Senegal, and the survivors get on this raft, and they're floating around, and they have no idea if they'll be saved, and all kinds of things happen on this raft, even going so far as cannibalism, they say, and you know there were survivors because we know what happened, we have the reports. But basically, Jericho shows us this moment of hope when they think they see a ship in the distance. And the figure she's chosen is, I think, one of the most interesting figures in the whole piece. Sort of, they try to make that pose. Like, it's not easy. And, you know, again, speaking of layers of appropriation and borrowings, Jericho, very well known for drawing on the Laocoon for his figures on this raft, who, you know, even though they're dying, they're very well-developed musculature. You see, you know, they're starving, basically, and they're floating out at sea for days and days, but they're pretty ripped. And there they are. And, you know, so Lee and that relationship and why she's chosen that particular element, I mean, again, that's something that is a question for the artist that I would love to ask her, and I will someday. But, again, that detective work in recognizing and sort of the layers in the paint in her painting in and of itself, sort of that shade, like, oh, I think I know it. I'm pretty sure I do. And this hugely iconic work from French Romanticism. So, again, a really interesting moment of engagement. Now, someone mentioned Gordon Bennett from last, that you know, how do sort of more contemporary works fit into, and the whole notion of, indigenous art in Australia, and I'm sort of moving through for this now in terms of thinking through that archival component I mentioned at the beginning. But Gordon Bennett, of course, and there are people in this room who know a lot more about Gordon Bennett than I do. But I did want to mention this work. Now, again, I remember when I arrived in Brisbane, and this used to be positioned, you know, the escalator near the water mall in Quag, and I think it was up there at the top. And I used to kind of go up and go, oh yeah, I'm going to teach my Renaissance art course now. And then I'd see this, I'm like, wow, I have to think about this work someday and unpack and think through the different ways that Gordon Bennett includes such specific references to Renaissance perspective, to antiquity over there with the triumphal arch, and you know, systems of perspective in terms of the layering going on here. I mean, to me, it immediately brings up Masaccio's Trinity, which is one of these first instances of expression around how a vanishing point and three-point perspective works in art. And he's here, you know, pulling it all together with, you know, Truganini on the left. I think he's drawn on a photograph of his mom, who was a domestic servant, and here, there she is in the place where you'd normally expect the Virgin Mary. I mean, this is a very layered and complex and gripping work of art that uses these past recognizable elements to a new force, right? And makes us sort of, you know, and certainly makes me as a Renaissance art historian sort of question and think through now this new message, this new delivery of a use of those recognizable iconic elements to an entirely different effect. You know, situating all of this in a distinct Australian landscape. And I think I was very interested to read how... You know, and Ben, of course, very known, well known for challenging racial stereotypes and critical reflection on Australia and Australia's colonial past and systems of power that surround us. And in particular, I think those Western elements are meant to be indicators of that. But it was, yeah, how on close inspection, this is direct from Artlines, you know, our excellent magazine here, the sand hills are revealed as human intestines. Like, I did not notice that. And extrapolated from Bennett's copy of Color Atlas of Human Anatomy. So again, a nod to Australia's bloody colonial history. So this is an absolutely breathtaking work of art in the context of everything that we've just worked through. Okay, I'm going to, it's just going on 11. We'll do all questions sort of after the Q&A, but what I want to quickly show you now are some examples of, and the whole notion of an archival aesthetic is something that is worthy of a lecture in and of itself, but I did want to put these forward as very important, and you know, you can almost chart out a kind of artistic, rather archival aesthetic that is simmering and working through, like in terms of indigenous art and thinking through the relationship and rapport and use of colonial images. There's so much interesting material to pull on and an entire lecture to craft out of that. But again, it's pointing to that borrowing impulse and the reuse and remake and remodel of past materials. And someone like Brooke Andrew, I mean, again, there was a large exhibition of his works at UQ Art Museum that was absolutely breathtaking, and these enormous uses of past engravings and etchings that, so there was a particular series by a Prussian naturalist from the 19th century, William Blendowski, and he depicted at the time, you know, figures that he was encountering upon a voyage to Australia. And Brooke Andrew, I think, takes these and subverts, you know, what's being shown here, you know, a kangaroo being brought down by a pack of hunting dogs, and stories from early colonial history suggested that, you know, kangaroos were somehow something to be feared. And in the original German text, which accompanies the original etching, it says, it has happened that a kangaroo has grabbed a person, carried him to water, and submerged him until he is drowned. So these, like, reportage from, you know, early encounters. And, you know, there you have an image of an Aboriginal man who's incorporated in the background, his club raised above his head. I mean, is he in hunting? Is he trying to warn? You know, so, you know, it's a shame I have no time. But basically to suggest that drawing on those found materials and those older etchings, Andrew can develop a kind of critique of previous colonial conceptions of Australia from their initial encounters. And once you start thinking that through as a thematic in the kind of art practices that are emerging today, there are all kinds of fascinating examples. So like Danny Meller and the way he's taken a kind of seemingly idyllic presentation of Queensland, and there's in fact a menacing element above with a, there's a figure of a sort of European settler sort of observing this idyllic scene, that, you know, there's an element, absolutely an element of subversion here. And same with Daniel Boyd, who takes this very serious, difficult subject matter of the way workers were mistreated or, you know, basically treated as slave labor. I mean, Daniel Boyd has Aboriginal and South Sea Islander heritage and very intent on this topic of the laborers who were brought to Queensland in the late 19th century and treated like slaves, and sugar plantations and how they came up as a result of slave labor, and then the horrific treatment of these people when the White Australia policy was enacted. So, and he has this, I mean, there's a huge exhibition of his works recently in Sydney, and I loved seeing this because it was amazing to see the scale of these works. And what I find interesting there is that kind of the almost pointillism and the way it's, again, layers of history. I mean, he has this very interesting process of the raised dots sort of making the image murky and almost like newsprint or, you know, again, shady. We can't quite make everyone out, but when they're on the large scale, they're absolutely incredible to get up close to. But again, a very difficult image. So the white settler there overseeing the labor and, you know, again, this critique, this subversion of this found material and brought to a very distinct life in the work of Daniel Boyd. So I will leave it there because I know it's time for a break. This is the end of the lecture. And thank you for your attention. And I'm really looking forward to talking with Ryan in a few minutes. But enjoy your break, and we'll take time for questions at the end of the whole thing. Thank you very much.